Classification also leads into genetics, and as you know, there can be genetic causes of dystonia. I think when you think about does genetic cause any condition, there are various ways it can. If you think of high blood pressure, stroke, heart disease, you can often see that there are more people than you'd expect get this in one family than another family. And in this sort of condition, it's because they probably have a handful of what we call susceptibility genes, genes that make it more likely they'll develop it, and that's why you see it clustering in one family or than another. Normally, when we talk about genetic, what we're talking about is there's one gene, and that gene becomes faulty, and if the gene's faulty, it'll produce the condition. And in neurology, probably a prime example of this is Huntington's disease, which has nothing to do with dystonia, but is a serious, progressive, fatal disorder where one gene has the same genetic defect and it produces the condition in all the people. For dystonia, it's a bit more complicated in that we now know there are probably 29 different genes which can form different types of dystonia. But the important thing with all these classifications is most of those are incredibly rare, and there are a few common ones, and those are the ones we learn the most from. So for isolated dystonias, where dystonia is the only problem, there are really three main genes, and probably the most common one is called the DYT1, so it stands for dystonia 1, so it was the first gene to be found. The DYT1 gene, which produces childhood onset generalised dystonia. Generalised means affects a lot of the body. This is one of the more disabling and devastating forms of dystonia. Usually comes on in infancy or adolescence, affecting the arm or leg, and then spreads to involve other parts of the body, although strangely doesn't affect the face usually or the neck. DYT1 is inherited in a way we call dominant. Now, it gets a bit complicated, but basically we have two copies of every gene in all the cells of our body, one copy you got from your mum, one from your dad. And in these type of conditions, all you need is one copy of the gene to be faulty, and you'll develop the condition. So what that does mean is if you have that gene and you're having children, you can either give them your good copy or your bad copy. So for your kids, there's a 1 in 2 chance they'll inherit the bad gene. But there's a very important fact about most of the dystonia genes, which sets it a bit apart from a lot of other neurological conditions, in that we know that for DYT1, for instance, you can carry that bad gene throughout your life and still never develop dystonia. And in actual fact, for the people who carry the faulty DYT1 gene, probably only about 30% of them will develop some form of dystonia in life. Now, for some, that's a severe childhood onset dystonia. For others, it can be writer's cramp in later life. So, and that's what we call reduced penetrance. And that's very important when we give information about the risk to children and brothers and sisters about developing these conditions. Two other genes which we know about which cause isolated dystonia. There's a DYT6, and that encodes a protein called THAP1. And again, that has a slightly different picture. It tends to come on a bit later in life, so early adult life, and it tends to affect the head, the neck, and often the larynx, so they get a laryngeal dystonia. And then there's another one called DYT25. You can see the dystonia genes have hit 25 now, and that causes, again, a more limb and neck dystonia in adult life. So often the different genes produce a different pattern of dystonia. Then there's a group of the complicated or secondary dystonia genes, of which dopa-responsive dystonia is the one that we hope to diagnose, even though it's very, very rare. And this is a condition where the gene defect produces a problem in the way we produce dopamine in our brains. Dopamine is a very important chemical messenger for how we control our movements, and effectively, if this pathway doesn't work well, we don't produce enough dopamine and people develop dystonia. Now, many of you will know that dopamine is also very important for Parkinson's disease, but the difference between dopa-responsive dystonia, the genetic form, and Parkinson's disease is in Parkinson's disease, you get it much later and it's due to death of dopamine-containing cells. In dopa-responsive dystonia, the cells don't die, they just can't produce as much dopamine. And for that reason, it's really important to recognize because it responds dramatically well to levodopa, which is the main treatment for Parkinson's disease. It's a drug taken up in the body, it gets into the brain, gets into the brain cells, and is turned into dopamine. So you're replacing that which people are short of. So it's important to recognize that form. Another form of complicated dystonia, which isn't due to cell degeneration, is myoclonus dystonia, where people usually develop dystonia, often writer's cramp or cervical dystonia. But in addition, they get these very brief jerks affecting the upper body and the arms, which can be quite disabling. And again, this is a dominant condition. It's a different gene that produces it. And it tends to come on adolescence and then tends to plateau. The jerks respond quite well to some medications, but also the jerks respond very well to the deep brain stimulation. So again, for classifying and recognizing this, tends to direct how we would treat it. The same is true for dope-responsive dystonia. If we know someone has that condition or we've identified that genetic change, we know we really should be treating those people with levodopa. And for instance, for DYT1 dystonia, knowing the genetic problem and the fact the child or the adult has got a bad dystonia, we know that people who've got that particular form of dystonia respond very well to deep brain stimulation of the globus pallidus. So again, knowing that gene means you'd probably consider DBS earlier or sooner in their course of action because you know it's got a very good chance of being successful. So one of the factors about knowing the genes is it helps us diagnose them. It helps us determine which treatments are best for those people. The other thing about knowing the gene is you can give information to the family, and that's quite important. It's so-called genetic counselling or giving them what the risk is. So as I said, for DYT1 dystonia, the fact that most people who carry the mutated or the abnormal gene don't develop dystonia means actually the risk to relatives is quite low. So if, for instance, I had DYT1 dystonia, the risk to my brothers and sisters or any kids I had is probably being calculated around 14%. So that's quite low, and it means that you'd need to think very carefully about whether you want to use that genetic information. Knowing you have a gene, that means that some members of the family could certainly be tested for that gene to see if they're ever likely to develop it. And some people just like to know what's in store for them if they can, so they can life plan or they can think about it, or it also helps them when they're thinking about kids. For more fatal and disastrous genetic disorders like Huntington's disease, patients sometimes use that information to help make sure that their kids don't develop dystonia. So they have what's called prenatal testing or even pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, which is a bit like a test tube baby, and they'll test the fetus in the test tube to make sure it hasn't got the bad gene, and then that's implanted back into mum. Now for dystonia, that's a much more tricky and ethical issue, and there are very few examples of that happening because dystonia by and large in any of the genetic forms is not fatal. It can be disabling in DYT1, but there's reasonably effective treatments. So actually it raises a lot of issues whether or not you'd want to do prenatal testing or whether you'd actually want to go through the issues of pre-implantation genetic testing, which I know has happened on a few occasions. But doing any of those procedures does actually put the pregnancy at risk. So there are some risks to the fetus. So these are careful issues which must be discussed with counsellors if people are thinking about that in the future.